So, good afternoon, everybody. It is a real pleasure for me to be standing here and present Dr. Yusuke Nakamura, with whom I have very special ties, among others, a very close collaboration that we have extended over the years, and also a personal relationship, even with my husband and my family. I thank him very much for coming today, and I thank all the delegation of Japanese researchers that have taken the long trip from Tokyo to arrive and give the workshop that is going on today, yesterday, and today. I would like to tell that before I start, that our Director General is not able to join us because he's strengthening ties with Japan. It turns out that after the G20 meeting, there was an initiative done to make a special research and development 20 for clean energy technologies. And I am very proud to say that Cinvestav is participating as the only institution from Mexico. And Dr. Mustre is giving Cinvestav presentation. So without further ado, I would like to read a little bit about Professor Nakamura, who in the past two decades has made important contributions to genomic medicine and cancer research. He was one of the pioneers in applying genetic variations, VMTR and SNP markers, and genomic to the medical field. Polymorphic DNA markers have allowed mapping and cloning genes responsible for inherited diseases, susceptibility to common diseases, response to medications, and genes involved in cancer. For those of you working in the biological field, you know how important the P53 pathway is, and it was his group that reported on many genes involved in this pathway that were participating in the repair and apoptosis in P53-dependent DNA. After conducting a comprehensive analysis of the expression and functional profile, his group has reported dozens of genes with key roles in many types of cancer. Some of them are good molecular targets for the development of anti-cancer drugs and are in one to three phases of clinical trials. Dr. Nakamura has published almost 1,500 articles in journals such as the New England Journal of Medicine, The Lancet, Nature, Science, the American Journal of Genetics, Cancer Research, and many others. His articles have been cited more than 140,000 times in the scientific literature. In addition, he has been a mentor to more than 300 doctors and students in the last 25 years, many of whom have taken very important academic positions. It is thus my privilege to introduce Professor Nakamura to this colloquium. Thank you very much.
So thank you for the kind introduction. I'm very happy to see Martha again. And we met several years ago when we celebrated the relationship between Mexico and Japan. Since then, we have been working together, and I'm very happy to send some delegate to teach the biomatics in young Mexican scientists. Today, I'd like to talk about our ongoing project of the cancer patient medicine, and also, as you can find, I'm directing the program, so-called strategy innovative program supported by Japanese government for a hospital. This is my COI, and as already Martha mentioned, I published more than 1,500 articles and have been cited 174,000 times, and as I served as editor-in-chief for cancer science and Journal of Human Genetics for the last 20 years. And people think I'm a basic scientist through these kind of publications, but I'm not simply a basic scientist. I'm still working together with cancer patients. Let me introduce my background very briefly. So this is a picture of myself. Maybe you cannot recognize this is me. This is a picture of nearly 30 years ago. I worked as a surgeon and operated a gastric colon cancer patient. So my basis of research is basically generated through my age as a surgeon. I had many questions as an oncologist. First of all, I wondered how and why normal cells are transformed to malignant cells, and why the progression rate of cancers in individual patients are so enormously different, and also why the individual patients show a big difference in response to anti-cancer drugs. Although many drugs have been developed, still their effectiveness are quite different by individual. And also, why some patients show very severe toxic reactions. This is one of the very important questions we need to address. So I took genetics and genomics to address these kind of questions. The reason I took genetics is my loss of the young cancer patient. When I was 27 years old, I declared death of 27 years old female gastric cancer patient. And also, I watched the death of 36 years old colon cancer patient who left two small children behind him. So I wondered why the cancer developed in such young age of patient. And I searched the literature and found this syndrome called the Lynch syndrome. This is a hereditary non-polyposis cancer syndrome. As you can find, this is age 53, and this patient had a colon cancer at age 23. So I was interested in this kind of hereditary cancer syndromes, and I found this disease called familial adenomatous polyposis. So this is a resected colon from the FAP patient. All of these small nodules are polyps. This patient developed thousands of polyps, and this big one is already a cancer. And I found this pedigree in Salt Lake City. So this is a Mormon pedigree in Salt Lake City in Utah State in the United States. So I wanted to find the cause of this syndrome, and I decided to move to the United States in Salt Lake City. So first of all, I didn't study well, and I thought it is easy to isolate the gene responsible for familial polyposis coli, but I found it's very difficult to distinguish the paternal origin or maternal origin of chromosomes. You can look these kind of chromosomes through microscope, but of course you cannot say which is maternal origin, which is paternal origin. So I had to find the DNA markers, polyp-DNA markers, to distinguish these two chromosomes, paternal origin or maternal origin. And I isolated many DNA markers, and this kind of marker can be applied to distinguish the two chromosomes, paternal and maternal, and we can say one chromosome is lost in cancer cells. This is three examples. You can see the two banding N is a normal tissue, but in tumor tissue, one band was lost, indicating so chromosome was lost in cancer cells. This is one the mouse I introduced called the BMTR markers published in Science in 1987. You can see how chromosomes are transferred from grandparents to parents to children. This is a cartoon. You can follow this band. Is transferred from paternal the grandmother to father, and this one is transferred from paternal the grandfather to father and transferred to children. This kind of the separation of chromosome, whether paternity or paternal or maternal origin, is very important to apply for the so-called reverse genetics. But this is the history of DNA markers. I feel I'm getting old because you can find the name of Nakamura in 1987. This Nakamura is myself. So I reported the DNA markers in 1987. These kind of DNA markers, chronic DNA markers, are very important to find the genes responsible for genetic disease and also find the chromosomal loss in cancer cells. This is one of the markers to identify tumor suppressor genes. And also, I have worked on the SNP, single nucleotide polymorphism. Those are very important for identifying the gene susceptible to various common diseases and also genes related to drug responses. And as I mentioned, I worked on the SNPs. Basically, the database for the single nucleotide polymorphism, SNPs, had been made by this international HAPMAP consortium. This is a meeting held in the University of Tokyo campus. And Francis Collins is here, and I'm here. And actually, we reported three papers. This is a 205 paper, reported the summary of 1 million SNPs in African, Asian, and Caucasian. And we published three papers, all together, three papers having cited more than 15,000 times. In this project, as you can see, I also led the institute called LECAN, LECAN Center for Genetic Medicine. You can see the contribution to this project. 24.3% was the highest contribution to the international HAPMAP project. So I led this group, and we contributed the highest contribution to the international HAPMAP project. And this is very important because this is kind of the basic information to do the germline association studies. Back to the cancer. So, in 1989, the year I left Utah, we published two key papers. One is a first one in Science. So this is a paper analyzed all of the chromosomes in colon cancers. This is the first paper analyzed all human chromosomes. And the second paper is a first discovery of p53 mutation in human cancers. Also reported in Science. And last two papers were published in Science in 1995. This is the isolation of the FAP gene, Adenomatous Polyposis coli gene. As you can see, it's a kind of the domino. We found the mutation in the APC gene in the FAP patient. In addition, working together with Bart Vogelstein in Johns Hopkins University, we reported the multi-step culture genetics model of colon cancer. When the APC is mutated, polyp arises in colon, and if KRAS mutation is added, polyp gets larger, and subgene p53 mutation is added, so benign tumor becomes the malignant tumor cancer. We reported this kind of model, and for many cancer types, this kind of multi-step calcium analysis were reported subsequently. So my goal of research is to improve the quality of life of cancer patients. actually, we would like to improve the survival rate of cancer patients. This is the 10-year cancer-specific survival reported 2 years ago in Japan. So stage 1, 2, 3, you can see the higher number. Means that if we can find a cancer at the early stages, we are able to cure cancer. So this is one of the good indicators. How we should cure cancer? So one of the best ways is that we should find the cancer at the early stages. However, when you look at the esophageal cancer, bile duct cancer, liver cancer, pancreatic cancer, the numbers are so terrible. Even stage 2 of pancreatic cancer, survival is only 9%, lower than 10%. This means that even if being diagnosed at the early stages, some type of cancer still have a very poor prognosis. So how we should do to improve the cancer cure rate? The answers are obvious. We should improve the cancer screening rate. We should find the cancer at the early stages. There are many ways. We should provide everybody with the cancer screening method, or we should develop easier and cheaper screening method to identify cancer at early stages. And also, we should find the recurrence or relapse as early as possible. Now, diagnosis of metastasis or relapse are done when we find something in images, X-ray, CT, or MRI. But if we can detect the cancer as early as possible, we may be able to start the treatment earlier and maybe to cure cancer more effectively. And also the drug selection is very important. We should select the right drug at the right time to the right patient. So if we provide inappropriate treatment to cancer patients, so of course cancer progresses. So it's very important to provide the most appropriate drug at the beginning of the treatment. And also we need to develop a new type of drug. We need to develop the molecular targeted drugs more and more. And also we should focus on the immunotherapy. I will talk a little bit about the neoantigen vaccine treatment later. And we have some success. I would like to show and share our information with you. This is the schematic design of the cancer prevention medicine that I propose. We should divide the cancer prevention medicine into three parts. One is to detect the cancer cells as early as possible by liquid biopsy. I will have to explain later. And once we identify the cancer, we should characterize the nature of individual cancer cells by sequencing or proteomics. Any other tools, we should characterize cancer cells in detail. And then we should select a drug based on the genomic information or omics information. We should pick up the target drugs that should work on the particular patient. But still there, in Japan, one third of cancer patients die of cancer. We need to develop a new type of drugs by molecular target drug or immunotherapy. I'd like to explain about the immunotherapy later. In addition, the medicine becomes more and more complicated. We need lots of information, and we need a personalized treatment. It's almost impossible to look at the data and analyze the data by our eyes or our brain. So the AIs, artificial intelligence, is very important to further improve the medical care or cancer care. So AI is essential for the education of medical workers to keep updated information, and AI is essential for the selection of drugs, and AI is very important for assist the informed consent process, and AI also helps the patient to better understand the medical treatment. Now the knowledge gap is getting bigger and bigger. For patient or patient family members, it is more and more difficult to understand the world to explain by doctors. So now I'm leading this Japanese government program, and Professor Miyano, also here, is helping me as a sub-program director. This is a huge program, And last year we had the 25 million USD. This year we have 30 million USD budget. And I'd like to explain why we need AI. As I mentioned, the medical system has been developing by the advances in researches, not only in medicine. So we need engineering, we need pharmacology, and we also need genomics. And basically, medicine becomes more advanced, more complicated, and more personalized. The aims of the governmental programs are develop AI hospital system using AI, IoT system, ICT technologies with big data, and implement them into the clinical practice and to provide highly advanced medical services without reduction of the workload of doctors or nurses. If medicine is developed in general, the workload is getting higher and higher. But using AI, we have to reduce the workload of doctors and nurses. So as you know, Japan is facing to the very aging, highly aging society. So we need to contribute to the maintenance of the high quality of medical care system, and also we need to reduce the national medical cost, and also we need to enhance the international competitiveness in the medical field. And also, as I mentioned, we need to reduce the workload of medical workers. This is the future vision of AI hospital. We need to integrate everything. Everything means the environmental factors, lifestyles, and also many vital signs. And also we need to integrate the genetic analysis, the imaging analysis, and also the pathological diagnosis. So we are trying to make a big database by integrating all kinds of information obtained from the patient and developing AI, and AI can help their diagnosis or picking up the most appropriate treatment to patient. So why we need the big medical database? So through the medical database, we can identify the genetic and lifestyle risk factors related to diseases. This is very important for the personalized prevention of disease or prevention of the disease progression, and can provide a personalized health care. So identification of disease causes or mechanisms can help development of new diagnostics and treatment. And also, we need to find a commonness and differences in individual patients, even the same disease. So we understand really big differences among the patients. So accurate diagnosis is very important for the precision medicine, to diagnose accurately and provide the most appropriate medications. These kind of things, to provide the elongation of healthy lives and shortening the treatment period, and this causes the reduction of the individual medical costs. In addition, as you know, Japan has a very high risk of the disasters, particularly earthquakes. So in the Tohoku area, we had a big earthquake in 2011. Many individuals lost their medical information entirely. So they had a very hard time because they do not know what kind of treatment they receive. So if we can keep the big data in two places, we can always provide the medical record to individual patients. This is very important, like Japan, because of the still we are facing the high risk of big earthquakes and tsunami. And also, the AI function is required in many clinical areas, particularly imaging and pathological diagnosis is very important. If we can use AI for diagnosis of CT scan, MRI, X-ray, so we can provide accurate information to the people wherever they live in Japan. This is a schematic presentation, what we need. This is the figure showing the x-axis is a number of CT or MRIs per 1 million people. The y-axis is a number of radiologists to diagnose. You can see Japan is very extreme position. So in Japan, CT or MRI density is 5 to 6 times higher compared to the other OECD countries. It means that we can produce large number of pictures of imaging, but we don't have enough number of radiologists. That means already over capacity of the production of images. Because of that, we need to develop AIs which can say this is abnormal. And also pathological diagnosis. The number of the clinical pathologists is decreasing every year. We don't have enough pathologists to lead the slide. And so we need the automated diagnostic system with AI. This is critically important to maintain the quality of diagnosis of cancers and other diseases. And also censoring system is very important. Now the many wearable tools are available to detect the ECG or pulse or breathing. This is one of the examples. This is not the cancer. But atrial fibrillation is a very serious problem because this disease is found 1 in 20 to 30 individuals in the age group of 70 or higher. Some patients are non-symptomatic. Just they are found by cerebral embolisms. We can now measure the pulse by wearable tools like a smartwatch. If we can identify the individuals having atrial fibrillation, we can use an anticoagulation and prevent this kind of cerebral embolisms. This is one of the ways, and the other way is if something happens, this kind of sensing system can send the information to the emergency system. And they can send the ambulance car to the patient and pick up the patient and send the patient to the hospital. We can avoid the complication by cerebral embolism, cerebral infarction. So this is very important. If the patient were found late, usually they become disability. So to avoid this kind of disability, we need this kind of monitoring system. And our human cause errors often. If we can detect the errors by AI, we can provide a safe treatment to cancer patients. So sometimes doctors didn't read the imaging pictures and providing the wrong drug to the patient. So if we can monitor these kind of mistakes by AI, we can provide a safer treatment to individual patient. And also, as I mentioned, the knowledge gap is getting bigger and bigger. The amount of medical literature becomes 30 times bigger every year. It's almost impossible to monitor all of the literature. Because of that, so knowledge gap is bigger. If knowledge gap gets bigger, so communication between doctors or nurses and patient family members are getting more difficult. So we need to develop some kind of AI e-learning system to share the essential information among doctors, among nurses, and can share the information among all the people in the country. And also, now doctors spend lots of time to watch keyboard and monitors, and eye contact time is getting shorter and shorter. So shorter eye contact time makes the quality of medical management poor. To keep the eye contact time between the patient and doctors, or nurses and patients, so we are trying to make a system to convert the conversation between the patient and the doctors into the electronic medical record system or nursing record system by AI. And also, this is complicated, just the informed consent process can be covered by AI too. So this is one of the examples. One hospital basically examined and find about 30% working hours are spent for making nurse record. So nurses spend lots of time for making record and do not have enough time to contact with patient. If we can make an AI using a microphone, and the microphone can pick up the conversation and they're making it into the nurse record, so nurses can spend more time by interaction with patient. And this kind of AI is also very important in medical field. And also we are trying to make an AI platform. AI platform contains many tools of AIs, important or essential for medical field. For example, if we click here, we can get what kind of information you need. Ultrasound diagnosis, or you need assistance of CT, MRI reading. So the computer can ask you what kind of information you need. And if you click there, then in Japan now, endoscopic diagnosis is also supported by AI. So it can reduce the mistake of the reading or watching the endoscope. Anyway, I've been working on many fields, work with many companies, and trying to make many AI tools by collaboration with companies or collaboration with hospital people. Let's come back how to improve the cancer cure rate. As I mentioned, to find the cancer at early stage is very important. So one of the ways to find the cancer at early stage is liquid biopsy. So liquid biopsy contains various meanings. Some people say they want to find circulating tumor cells by liquid biopsy and making a xenograft model. So we are interested in circulating tumor RNA, circulating tumor DNA, to identify the fused genes for identification of the cancer-specific mutations using blood. And some scientists in Japan are using exosomes to identify cancer-derived component. But we are mainly focusing on the circulating tumor nucleic acid. In addition to the blood, some people are using saliva or effusions and also urine. Urine may be a good source to screen the bladder cancer or kidney cancers, but we have been focusing on the blood and have been analyzing the blood samples in the last 3 years. This is a paper published by Johns Hopkins Cruz last year, February, and they mentioned 70 to 80% of resectable cancer can be detected by the liquid biopsy. For example, ovarian cancer or liver cancer can be detected at nearly 100% accuracy, and other types of cancer can be detected at 60 to 70% frequency. This is really important because sometimes people don't have enough time to go to have a cancer screening, but if the blood drawing is enough to screen cancer, many people can have access to the cancer screening. This is the data generated by around the row in somewhere here. So we analyzed 67 lung cancer patients, and she identified the abnormalities in 58% of the cases. This is a summary by stages. Although numbers at stage 1 and stage 2 is small, we are quite confident. Even at stage 1 or stage 2, we can detect the lung cancer at the accuracy of 60 to 90% or 100%. This is very important. So, as I mentioned, lung cancer need to be found at the early stage, because stage 3, stage 4, their prognosis are so poor. And liquid biopsy has some advantages. As you know, the lung cancer is treated by molecular target drug. So 40% or so of lung cancer patients in Japan have their own molecular target drugs. But the problem is if we use drug A, so some cancer cells are basically resistant. So blue part of cancer cells were killed, but the green part of cancer cells that is resistant to drug A increase. We don't have any way to find the switching of clones during the treatment. But liquid biopsy is good because the half-time of the circulating DNA, circulating RNA is very short. So liquid biopsy always reflect the real-time tumor conditions in cancer patients. This is one of the examples. This patient had the ALK mutation and treated with a number of drugs. And then received the drug called Centine. So this is the information. This is the information before the treatment with Centine. We can find the multiple mutations in ALK gene. So the three different types of mutations were found before the treatment. Also, we found the KRAS mutations. What happened after the treatment? So this, the lower ABU17 is the data after the treatment. You can see the drastic decrease of the certain ALK clone. However, you can see increase of other type of mutation in this patient. Meaning this drug is sensitive to basically the great majority of cancer cells are sensitive to this drug, but small fraction of cancer cells might be resistant to this drug. So obviously the KRAS mutation increase means a clonal switch occurred during the treatment. As I mentioned, clonal switches can be detected by liquid biopsy. And also, liquid biopsy can affect the intratumor or intertumor heterogeneity. So, by biopsy, we can get information of one tumor or a small fraction of one tumor. But liquid biopsy, in general, reflect the entire condition of the cancer patient. This should be more useful than biopsy of one tumor. So the liquid biopsy can apply for the cancer screening or can detect the minimal residual disease. And we can use the liquid biopsy for selection of molecular targeting drug. And we can monitor recurrence or relapse by liquid biopsy, can start the treatment as early as possible. And also, we can monitor the response to the target therapeutics. So although I do not have enough time to show all of the data, but liquid biopsy is very useful or important to get the real-time information of the cancer patient. So the last part of my talk is immunotherapy. So we have been working on immunogenomics, so-called immunogenomics, or I say immunopharmacogenomics. I like to show how T cell clones were changed during the treatment. This patient was a lung cancer patient, 79 years old, and he was diagnosed to have a lung cancer, and already he had a widespread of metastasis in chest and in the abdomen. So doctor somehow provided radiation therapy to one side because of the lung mass is very big, but never worked, and he received nivolumab treatment. This drug worked very well. You can see the mass here disappeared completely in 3 months, and this mass become much smaller in 3 months, and this is also got smaller. So we obtained this mass subcutaneous metastasis after the treatment, and we analyzed the T cells, whether T cells are clonally expanded or not. That was our question. This is the answer. Very strong clonal expansion of CD8 T cells was observed in this particular patient. This is the CDR3 sequences. This is very important for the recognition of antigens. As surprisingly, we found 20 to 25% of the alpha beta sequences were monoclonal, indicating some type of T cells expanded. We believe this is a T cell that killed the cancer cells. So the clonal expansion of T cells is very important to make the immunocheckpoint inhibitors effective to cancer patients. And surprisingly, same clone was found in particular blood. This is before the nivolumab treatment. This is the particular CDR3 sequences. So we found 6% of peripheral blood contained this T cell receptor sequence. And after the treatment, this became 21%. This is surprising. Usually the peripheral blood T cell clone types are really diverse, but in this case, so 20% of the T cells are basically derived from single T cell clone. Probably the radiation therapy stimulated the expansion of certain T cells, and nivolumab treatment further activated expansion of this particular T cells. So we need to think about how the PD-1, PD-L1 inhibitor works. This is the response rate of the immunocheckpoint inhibitors. So as you know, this drug didn't kill cancer cell directly. Basically, activate the cancer cell, activate the lymphocyte that can kill cancer cells. So because of the so expensive, do we need to select a patient? How to select a patient for this drug? So one of the indications was provided by this paper reported by Johns Hopkins University. That's a colon cancer, and individuals having a mismatch repair deficient means a very high number of somatic mutations. As I summarized here, high number of missense mutations generated a higher number of immunogenic neoantigens, and having more active T cells that are able to kill cancer cells. So we know more mutation, more new neoantigens, more active T cells, that is one of the indicators that the immunocheckpoint inhibitors work. So let's simplify. We have cancer cells in cancer tissue. In addition to cancer cells, we have an active lymphocyte that may be able to kill cancer cells. And also we have molecules or cells
that protect the cancer cells from immune attack. Depending on cancer patient, and some patients have more glucose cells in the immunoactive cells, but in some cases, the glucose lymphocyte is small. In general, if patients have a higher number of mutations, we can see the higher number of T cell, CD8 T cell infiltration. So, if simplify the cancer patient into two groups, higher number of active immune cells and lower number of immune active cells. So immunochecking aid can reduce the blue, black color molecules of black color cells, but still black color is stronger than number one. But if these black color molecules of cells are reduced and the blue color side becomes dominant, drug works well. So now we are trying to enhance immune response in cancer patients, because in this case, immunotherapy inhibitor never work. If we can increase the number of immunoactive cells, this drug may work, or this kind of treatment may work by itself. So I'd like to show some approaches where we developed cancer vaccines, two different types of cancer vaccines. One we call the ONC antigens, or some people call shared antigens, and the other one is a neoantigens. Neoantigens are highly specific to cancer cells because generated by genetic alterations. This ONC antigen is an antigen that overexpressed in cancer cells, but expressed only testes or fetal tissues. I'd like to show one of the examples. This is the ONC antigen vaccine used for the prevention of the relapse for esophageal cancer. We use three different vaccines. So the patient received the chemotherapy or chemoradiation and then received the surgery. If lymph node metastasis is positive and then HLA is this type, we provide the vaccination. If not this type, we just observe simply. This is a vaccination schedule, and I will show this there. So, we already monitored most of the patients for 5 years, and this is a 5-year point. As you can see, overall survivors are different two times. So, unvaccinated group only 30%, but vaccinated group around 60%. So based on this result, we started a phase 3 clinical trial, and we expect to have a result sometime next year. Still, you do not believe we have a lymphocyte that is able to kill cancer cells. I'd like to show the proof of the immune cells that are able to kill cancer cells. This is a video. Larger ones are cancer cells, the smaller one is a cancer-specific lymphocyte. Please look at this fingertip. You can see the drastic change of cancer cells in a moment. So lymphocytes are attacking, and then cancer cells are collapsed everywhere in this field. So this video clearly indicating we have a lymphocyte that are able to kill cancer cells. What we have to do is that we should increase the number of this kind of lymphocyte by vaccination or other methods. This is another video. So same lymphocyte. Green colors are cancer cells. Left side, cancer cell didn't express the antigen. Without antigen, the lymphocyte simply ignore cancer cells. Nothing happened. But please look at the right side. You can see the changes of the shapes of lymphocyte already. But you can see the drastic changes. Okay? Lymphocyte together around the cancer cells, shown by green curves. And you can see the disappear as green colors, but attack of lymphocyte pretty clear. The same as the previous video, basically lymphocyte make a hole in cancer cells and cause a collapse of cancer cell. It's a green color inside the cancer cell basically disappear. You can see the big differences between the left side and the right side, indicating. So we have a lymphocyte that able to kill cancer cells. So we are trying to the many methods to kill cancer cells. And Kazuma Kyotani in my laboratory is a very skillful bioinformatician. And it's easy to analyze genetic information of cancer cells. Once we get the somatic mutations, and also we can get the HLA information by normal DNA, the combination of HLA and somatic mutation, we can predict the possible neoantigens just by computer kinds of AI. So we can synthesize the peptide by machine, and then we can use the peptide to treat cancer patients. This is a paper reported 2 years ago. This is the neoantigen vaccine treatment reported in Nature 2 years ago for melanoma. And I'd like to show some data what we have been doing. We're using neoantigen, and basically neoantigen was added to dendritic cell and injected into cancer cell, injected into cancer patient. So we get the cancer tissue analyzer genetic information, and we also isolate a monocyte and differentiate it into the differentiate to the mature dendritic cell, and mix the mixture of DC and neoantigen was injected into cancer patients. This is the schedule for the treatment. So 2 weeks, 2 weeks, and 3 weeks, 3 weeks. And we measure immune responses by using the lymphocyte of cancer patient. This is one patient who had a pelvic cancer, and she had a vascular lung metastasis. So she had a surgery, and 2 years later, she was found to have a vascular lung metastasis, and received the chemotherapy, and received the immunocheckpoint inhibitor, that she had a autoimmune symptom in pituitary gland. And she was told to wait for your test. But her husband didn't give up and took patient to the clinic, and she received a neoantigen basic treatment. As you can see, this lung metastasis clearly shrunk in 3 months. And we examine the immune response in this patient. In this patient, we use a mixture of 10 neoantigens. Upper layer is a before treatment, lower is after treatment. You can see lots of black spots here. These black spots indicate the presence of lymphocytes that can react on antigen. So we clearly see these kind of responses in this patient, and this patient had a very good response. This is another patient who had a liver cancer with multiple lung metastasis, and the primary tumor was resected, he still had a lung metastasis, and he received a neoantigen treatment. You can see the metastasis here disappear in 5 months. And although it's a little bit difficult to see, we counted the spot, and we can see the increase of this black spot in this patient, indicating the lymphocytes were activated by neoantigen treatment. This is another example. She's 30 years old and had two small children, not had small two children. And you can see the big mass in the brain, stem of the brain. And she was told your life would be 1 month. But as you can see, she can start the neoadjuvant treatment in March this year. And you can see the shrunk, shrinking of tumors. She is still happy, alive, and doing a normal life. Although in this case, we combine with the chemotherapy, if you are a doctor, you can expect this patient might die early this year, but still she's alive. And this is very encouraging us to do this kind of treatment. Okay, I have to stop my talk here. Anyway, this research researches have been supported many scientists. This is my reunion party, and this is a member of the University of Chicago. I have thanked these people, and also I have thanked many patients who provided materials and cooperated with us. Thank you very much for your attention. If we can have a fresh tissue, we can also analyze the transcriptome. We can more accurately predict what kind of neoantigen is expressed in cancer cells. This is a big issue for the neoantigen area now, how to get the fresh tumors.
Thank you. So that the more you get into this, the most probably you will be treating people with cancer that are less advanced. And hopefully,
I personally believe we should provide this kind of neoantigen or oncogene treatment as early as possible. If patients have a higher risk of relapse or recurrence, we should provide this kind of treatment at the beginning. But because the present protocol forces patients to have a chemotherapy. So with chemotherapy, so our immune status is getting poor, getting worse and worse and worse. That doesn't make sense. After making the immune status worse and then provide immune therapy, that doesn't make sense. But it's very hard to convince the many doctors who prefer to provide chemotherapy.
Yes.
Thank you for the talk. I like to know some numbers about the lymphocyte cell. How many of them reach the target, cancer cells?
I'm sorry, I don't get your question.
Lymphocyte cells? Lymphocyte cells?
Los linfocitos? How many lymphocytes?
Lymphocytes.
Really reach the target in the tumor cells? Do you have any idea?
Depend on cancer types. So pancreatic cancer is very difficult because of the very pyrolysis. So lymphocytes cannot go into the cancer tissue. But the other cancer types are sometimes very easy. So many people are now trying to combine the TGF-beta inhibitor or VEGF receptor inhibitor to make the cancer tissue loose and make the lymphocyte going to the cancer tissue. So individual DNA is so large, I cannot say how many lymphocytes are basically reaching to the cancer tissue. So one thing that we have is we provide the vaccine treatment before the surgery, and then examine the cancer tissue after surgery. So we found the activated lymphocyte actually went to the cancer tissue. We didn't have any information before, but now we are able to do the T cell receptor sequencing. Then we can say whether lymphocyte returned to the cancer tissue or not by T cell receptor sequencing.
If there is another question.
Hi, David. Oh, So we can expect that the engineered lymphocytes is safely going into the...
You mean the T-cells, the engineered T-cells or the T-cells? So we have a system to generate the T-cell receptor engineered T-cells. So after eating tissue to repair T-cell receptor engineered T-cells, we are able to do within 2 months. But the problem is a cost to produce T-cell receptor engineered T-cells. As you know, the CAR T-cells cost 0.5 million USD per patient. So T-cell receptor engineered T-cells, we have to make personalized. That may increase the cost to produce the T-cell receptor engineered T-cells. So I have been discussing with one rich person to make a company to generate personalized T-cell receptor engineered T-cells. But it may take another 2 to 3 years. But this is one of the good directions to cure cancer.
So, thank you very much, Professor Nakamura, and thank you all also for attending this very interesting talk.